Now we have seen that there's a unique object, C-star algebra, which is generated by those Weyl relations, and so that's what we're now going to call the CCR algebra. So let me write down this definition. So the C-star algebra, which we see is uniquely determined by this. So the C-star algebra. Which is uniquely determined by the Weyl relations. With this I mean those relations which are denoted by star. So this C star algebra is usually called a CCR algebra over H. Of course, it depends on the underlying Hilbert space H. So this is called the CCR algebra over H. Or maybe if you want to make it more precise, maybe if you are talking to people in algebra, then maybe it's better to call it C-star algebra. Okay, but at least in operator algebraic context, it's just called CCC algebra. And it is denoted usually by just by CCR of H, by CCR of H. Sometimes you can do this more general, for a general symplectic form, sigma, which does not have to be the imaginary part of an inner product, then you denote it by this H. So then you can have a symplectic form on a real Hilbert space and then do the same construction. Or by CCR, and then you have a real Hilbert space in the sigma, which is a symplectic form, and so this here is a symplectic space. So for a general symplectic space, real Hilbert space, and a form which is anti-symmetric. Yeah, but this is not really relevant for us. Just that you, if you see it somewhere, it can be done in this generality without any big difference. Yeah, so that's now the algebraic object, which somehow we want to separate from the concrete representation on the Hilbert space. And maybe let me make a few remarks about this. So first of all, maybe what do we know about this, and then maybe why is it really good to look on this C-star algebra instead looking on representations on a Hilbert space. And I mean, typically the representations are faithful, so we are not really losing so much information about the norm structure or things like this, but still, why is it better to look on this object? So maybe, so this was maybe 11, probably this was 11.2. So this is now 11.3. A few remarks. Maybe the first remark, which I already said, is that actually what we proved there was that this C-star algebra is a simple C-star algebra. This is just a mathematical remark. So this theorem 11.1 implies in particular that this CCR algebra of H is a simple C-star algebra, which means that it doesn't have non-trivial closed two-sided ideals. And the reason is just that such a kernel, that such an ideal would be the kernel of a mapping from this C-star algebra, and this would mean that we would find realizations of those operators where elements are zero, which are not zero in some other representations. And that's what we have shown here. If something is zero for the W's, then it must also be zero for the W twiddles. Okay, and if this guy would not have been simple, then there would be operators somewhere where this would not be the case, where some W twiddles could be zero without that the W's are equal to zero. Good, okay, so that's just maybe just a different name for what we have proved. But maybe more importantly, in particular in our setting, is that knowing that this relations, the C-star algebra is simple, or that it's really determined by the relations, means that if I have some mappings on the level of the F's, I can lift them to the C-star algebra. So namely, if I have mappings which preserve essentially this structure. I mean, the whole information about the relations here only depends on this sigma here, or the imaginary part of the inner product. And if I now have some mappings on my Hilbert space, which are not changed, which are invariant under this guy here, then of course I have still again the same C-star algebra. So this means I get an automorphism which implements this mapping. So maybe let me be more precise. So if I have a linear mapping on the level of the underlying Hilbert space, so a linear mapping, let's say T from H to H, which preserves the only information about the Hilbert space which is showing up here in these while relations. So a mapping T which preserves the symplectic structure. And so with this I just mean that sigma of Tf, comma Tg is sigma of f, comma g for all f and g. So T is an isometry on the underlying Hilbert space. So that this can be implemented by a star automorphism on the CCR algebra. So this guy can be implemented. Okay, just a moment. So this can be implemented by a star automorphism, or as a star automorphism of the CCR algebra. Of CCR of H, or more precisely, so I have a star automorphism which is uniquely determined. So there exists a unique star automorphism. Let me call it gamma, and just to make sure that it depends on T, let me put a T there. So this is an automorphism of the C star algebra of my while relations over H to itself. CCR of H, which of course should map the W's in a way which is given by T. So such that of course the gamma T of W of F is equal to W of Tf. So the T tells me what happens to the arguments of my W operators. So it tells me what happens on a linear level. And then I can extend this to the whole algebra. And essentially, the relations tell me that I can really, that this mapping is compatible with also the product structure. Okay, and then of course we also know it goes over to the limit, because we know that everything is determined by this. Yeah, and of course this here follows from the theorem which we proved, because I mean I can just define those guys as my W twiddles, and then they satisfy the same relations. We just have to check that in this relation, because we assume the t doesn't change anything, we have exactly the same relations as before, so we have w twiddles, and this, by what we showed before, the C star algebra of the W's is star isomorphic to the one by the W twiddles, and this isomorphism is exactly this mapping here. So for the proof, we just have to put the W twiddle in our theorem before as the W of TF. And then what we proved in theorem 11.1 was exactly that we have a star isomorphism between the algebra generated by the W's and the algebra, just the C star algebra generated by the W twiddle. And this is exactly what we are claiming here, that we have a guy like this. And having such liftings, let's say, of these mappings T, or maybe you could say this is a kind of second quantization. So I mean, it's what I know something on underlying Hilbert space level T, and I lift this to the whole algebra. So I mean, I know something on the linear level, the underlying Hilbert space H. This is the linear level, which encodes objects which are generating algebra. Okay, so if I have mappings on the linear level, then I can lift them to the algebraic level, and actually to the C-star algebraic level. Okay, and such mappings T very often in physics correspond, let's say, to some symmetries which I have, or maybe even sometimes also to time evolutions of the considered system. And of course, I mean, we want, of course, lift those guys then to the whole theory which we have, and this here tells us that we can lift it to the CCR algebra. Yeah, but such automorphism, if we go to representations of our CCR algebra, then they do not need, we don't have to find unitaries which implement them. So this means on a concrete representation of our algebra, we don't really see those guys here as unitary mappings on the Hilbert space, as you would expect it. So this means we can implement those guys abstractly on the level of our algebra, but in representations, those guys don't correspond to unitary mappings. So we don't really see them concretely in our concrete Hilbert space. And again, this shows that it is just better to talk about those guys not in terms of representations, because there we cannot really define them, but much more on the higher level, on the algebraic level. And maybe I want to make a final summary about this, but before I do this, maybe I give you a short reminder of just a few properties of C-star algebra, so just that maybe again we have the right notion and language for talking about those things.